welcome everybody to today's webinar. It's our first of our community speaker series, and we're so thrilled to hear from our community members. And yes, so my name is Becky Migas, she, her pronouns, and I'm the founder and chief care connector for Women in Sustainability. I know a lot of you here today know about Women in Sustainability, but for those who are just joining us, we are an inclusive social and environmental justice nonprofit dedicated to caring for the people that care for the planet through community advocacy, resources, and education to create a sustainable and equitable future through the feminist viewpoint and leadership. Women in Sustainability really strives to create a safe space for like-minded and diverse individuals to create purposeful connections and conversation. All are welcome in this community. So a few items before we get started and pass it over to Katrina, because she's got so much to share with you today. Just a reminder, again, we will be recording today's session. We also have our closed captions turned on. You can toggle those closed captions on or off by hitting either hide or view subtitles. I'll also post something in the chat here shortly. And just a reminder to try to stay on mute during the presentation. There will be times that you will be able to unmute, but we want to be able to hear our speaker in the best form, and that is by staying on mute throughout. If you want to change your pronouns, as I mentioned, we try to work to be a really inclusive organization. You can change your pronouns by hitting the three dots over your name and adding in your pronouns through just typing them in and renaming yourself there. You can do this as you feel comfortable. I had already mentioned about the mute, but I'll just remind again, stay on mute. You'll have an opportunity to unmute and ask questions. You can also use that chat. If you're just joining us, pop open that chat, say hello. Answer our question of the day is, why do you want to start a garden? We'd love to hear from you. Utilize that chat throughout if you have questions. I'll be moderating that for Katrina, so feel free to post your questions in the chat. You'll also be able to raise your hand. So in your reactions buttons, there's a place you can raise your hands, and we'll call on you when the time is available. If you prefer not to unmute or ask questions in the chat, you can always just type to me in the chat as well, just a direct message. Okay, what else do we have? In addition to our questions, we also encourage you to repeat any statements you may like you hear from our presenter and share relevant information in the chat throughout. We just ask you to keep it to today's topic at hand, which is about gardening. And support our speaker. If you hear something you like, share it again in the chat. Click your fingers, clap your hands, or use those reactions down at the bottom to give our speaker just a little bit of love. It's just a great way to provide energy in this virtual space that we have today. And before we get started, I'm going to go ahead and do a quick introduction for Katrina. If there's anything in the chat, I'll pop over there in a second and answer those questions. But I am so thrilled to be welcoming today Katrina Karczewski. Katrina is the founder of Grateful Garden, and she lives in Denver, Colorado. She's been a gardener in the suburbs of Denver since 2011. She did not want owning a small yard in suburbia to stop her dreams of growing her own food. Instead, she made it her mission since becoming a homeowner to garden with intention. This allowed her to get closer to her food, the climate, and community that she is living in. Gardening off and on her entire life, she began at the age of 4 on her pop-pop's farm. In 2016, Katrina started a hobby saving and selling seeds. She found that people were more interested in learning how to save seeds or grow them than the seeds themselves. It took her a few years before deciding to turn her love for all things growing food and raised beds into a service business. She wants to be able to guide her clients to the process to shave years off their learning and growing curve. I'll click to that. Let learning from her growth and setbacks be your success story. She is grateful that she can create a place that community can come to for gardening, a gardening head start that she wished she had in her life. The phrase, if I knew then what I know now, often comes to mind for Katrina. As her garden consultant, designer, installer, Katrina is determined to have you comfortable saying, I'm a gardener. So please help me give a very warm Women in Sustainability welcome to my dear friend, Katrina.
Guys, thank you so much. I just feel so honored and blessed to get to be here with you all today. My name's Katrina Karczewski with Grateful Garden LLC. Thank you so much, Becky, for that awesome introduction. I really do want to know why you love gardening or are wanting to start gardening. So if you haven't already, go ahead and just drop that in the chat. And how we'll do this is I'm going to give you a ton of overview information. There's going to be a lot that we're going to go over today to start your garden successfully. And so there will be an opportunity to get a copy of these slides also, if you would like that. And of course, this is going to be recorded for you to go back to and opportunities to ask questions throughout. So thank you so much. So we're going to go ahead and get started on how to start a successful garden. So when we're talking about gardens, we're talking about food gardens here specifically. With food gardens, those are going to also include some pollinator plants and flowers, but we are talking mainly about growing food today. So thank you so very much. So the first question that we asked today was why? Why do you want to start your successful food garden? And I'm calling these a kitchen garden. So a kitchen garden, you know, we'll go over in a second what that means. And you don't have to answer any of these other questions right now, but I do want you to think about, especially if you're going to be working with me or someone like me in the future, or even doing this for yourself, is who is this for? Who will it feed? Who will visit your garden? What experiences do you want to have? What do you want to grow? What do you already eat? Where makes sense in your space? And where do you live? I saw in the chat already, not everyone is from Denver, Colorado. And the great thing about me teaching stuff from Denver is that all of this stuff will be useful for you no matter where you're at in the country. But it's going to be especially useful for you if you're at our altitude and our climate, having a raised bed kitchen garden. And how much time will you spend? How much money will you spend? How much energy do you hope that you receive from your garden? So those are all things to be thinking of as you're coming into spring and starting your kitchen garden. So a little bit about us. You know, Becky gave such a wonderful introduction that I'm just going to basically say that we design and install your custom kitchen gardens, and we coach you to be a confident and grateful gardener. So I do want to make sure that I get you to be able to say, I am a gardener. And, you know, that is not easy for us to claim something that we don't feel we are until we've arrived or reached a certain point. And I'm here to tell you that you are a gardener if you are gardening. And so we'll work on that as well, because we grow gardeners, not just gardens. And so raised bed kitchen gardens, I loved seeing some of you are going to be doing that this year even. I mean, gosh, Miles, 6 to 7 raised beds is just incredible. And so a kitchen garden, the word for that means just an outdoor garden that you harvest from daily for your meals. And why raised beds? There are so many benefits, including ease of gardening, control of the soil, control of the water, and just many more. So those are the two terms I usually get asked about the most, like what is a kitchen garden and why raised beds? So we're going to go over 4 key pieces to starting a successful raised bed kitchen garden. And as you're starting your gardens, the things you're going to be most needing to look at is your sunlight exposure, your water proximity, your convenience, and your aesthetics. Sunlight exposure. This is going to be 60% of your decision. You're going to need to find out where south is in your garden space, especially if you're in the same hemisphere that you know, we are in here in Denver, Colorado. If you're looking at this webinar from a different, you know, hemisphere, that's just going to be the opposite for you, but most of us are here. So you're going to place your garden where there are very few tall structures standing between your garden and south. So this is going to be the space in your yard that the most sun hits. My garden, as you see here, is on the north side of my yard, far enough away from my house to the south, that even in the winter, snow melts on this patch of my my yard first. And so that's a great Colorado trick. It's going to dump snow, and then you're going to see where that snow melts first. That's going to be your sunniest space. And you really just want to be on the southern side of any tall structure. And so on the southern side of your house, you know, or on the southern side of your fence, or on the southern side of your trees, that's where you're going to want to place your garden. So this is 60% of your decision. Next is water proximity. This is about 20% of your decision. If you have formal irrigation already, this is great. Be as close to that as possible with the number one also in mind. And we're going to make it on its own zone with a drip line. This is going to be a really fantastic way to conserve your water. You can water by hand or hose, but I'm going to tell you, you're going to still want to be really close to that water source to be able to do that. I know for me, I like having it on automatic because it just makes it so much more successful. So water proximity is going to be a really important part when you're designing your garden space. The next piece of this is going to be convenience. So this is something that we actually don't think of a lot when we're designing where our gardens are going to be. You're going to want to kind of put this kitchen garden in your way. You're going to want it to be designed with you in mind, and you're going to think about where your daily traffic is. So sometimes I hear people say like, oh, but I want it kind of tucked behind in that back corner and the farthest away from my, you know, door or whatever. And, I know that if you're not going to see it every day, if you're not going to walk by it, you're going to kind of neglect it a little bit. So it needs to be designed with you in mind, where your daily traffic is. And so that's about 10% of your decision. And then the last piece of this four steps is aesthetics. So when you're designing your garden, you want it to be beautiful. The more time spent in your space is going to be the places that you just feel the beauty of it, that you feel that this feels like a part of your home already. This doesn't feel like just an island onto itself. It's going to be, you know, built with the things in mind, like the special lines that already exist in your home and in your landscape. And so for these four concepts and these four ideas, you know, I did just want to kind of offer up the opportunity for us to dig into those a little bit more. Are there any questions that have come up when I, put these four pieces out there for you? Are there things that you guys need to know a little bit more about to see if any of that makes sense for you?
I see a bunch of like thumbs up, and yeah, I feel like this. How you have it set up.
Awesome. Well, I really appreciate that you guys are understanding those four key pieces of that. And with your convenience and your aesthetics, these are things that are really important for that. So we're going to get into a little more nitty gritty of the actual designing of your garden space. So for these key structures, in your garden space, you're going to have your raised bed with organic soils. And these are design elements that Grateful Garden LLC uses for all of our designs. So your next piece is going to be trellises. The piece after that is going to be your borders. And then you're going to have your pathways. So these are the four key structures for when you're designing your kitchen garden. And there are some really interesting pieces about this that I think a lot of people don't really realize that I love that I get to share with you. So raised beds and organic soils. First, I want to talk about the three mistakes to avoid. A lot of times when people are building their first gardens, they're not tall enough to grow the plants that you want to grow. And so when you're thinking about things that are ginormous, like tomatoes, you want a really tall bed to be able to fit that. The other part about it is too narrow or too wide. So these are the things when you're designing your garden. If it's too narrow, you're not going to get enough production out of it. If it's too wide, it's going to be uncomfortable as the human, you know, maintaining this garden to really work in that space. And then the other mistake I see a lot of is your boards. So your actual boards that you're building your bed out of, that they're not wide enough and thick enough to last long enough. And a couple of other things that I actually didn't even put here, but I really want to make sure I point out, is the fact that yes, the internet has some really cute and great and fantastic ideas for reusing and repurposing things. However, I really want you to just take a minute to think about what that product had before. So I want to just make sure that you don't go and repurpose some old railroad ties, let's say, because those are just laced with so many chemicals to be able to maintain the weight of a, you know, train going over it and to, you know, you live that long. And so really consider the life of the boards that you are using. I've seen really great things about, yeah, plastic storage tubs. Oh, it's so terrible. I've seen reusing old tires. And now if you are doing anything that you are going to eat from, and I love this community because you guys know this, but I really want to make sure that you are, you know, understanding the fact that whatever you're using is going to get into your foods. So that is a lot of things to basically say, make sure you're sourcing materials that are going to be the healthiest, best fit for you. So for height, when we're designing things, we usually do about 18 inches to 2 feet tall. That's going to be kind of the sweet spot for us. It's going to be just tall enough, you know, for all of those bigger plants. Smaller herbs and greens, you can have a smaller garden. You can have a 6-inch garden. That's okay. But you know, for the most part, when we're thinking of gardens, we're talking about bigger plants. The next piece is going to be control. So your raised beds, the control is probably my favorite part about this, especially for altitude, because you can control the soil. You can control the water. You know, in Denver, Colorado, we've got clay soil. It's not really great, for that. You can work the land forever, but it's just not going to, it's going to just suck up all the water, suck up all the nutrients. It's kind of like quicksand, easier to maintain weeds. It's way more comfortable for you, easier, for seeding and planting, and it's easier to cover. Oh gosh. Raise of hands. Who has ever been hit by hail in their properties? So it's so much easier to cover these and protect your plants when you are, you know, dealing with a hail or strong winds or storms or those things. Yeah, it's destroyed so many gardens. So it's going to be so much easier for you to maintain that. The next piece is confidence. It's an automatic garden. You have a great foundation. You know all of the materials in it. And then the last piece for raised beds is beauty, right? This acts as an extra room in your house. And for Grateful Garden LLC, I am just so honored and pleased to announce that we ethically and sustainably source Eastern Red Cedar. A Colorado family runs a sawmill and builds our products and sources this. Red cedar is actually an invasive species, and it's being culled out of these properties so that native species and trees can grow. And so we're not just thinking about the sustainability of the food itself, but it's also the thing that we're thinking about is our sourcing and our materials. And so you can't get much more sustainable than that. So I do want to just pause right here for a moment and answer any questions that looks like have come through. So Becky, would you like to lead us through those?
Yeah, definitely. So Molly had just mentioned that she's glad you mentioned the altitude, something that she wasn't even thinking of as being a significant factor. I think that we forget that in a lot of things.
Yes.
Miles had a question. Is it beneficial to get something deeper than 2 feet and then load the bottom with drainage, cardboard, et cetera?
Oh, Miles, that's a great question. You know, something deeper than 2 feet ends up being a little too tall if you consider the fact that the average person is about 5'5", right? So when you're starting at already 2 foot of being your ground level, and then those plants, especially tomatoes, are going to be growing for a very long time, and those are going to get a couple feet high, you're going to want to be able to reach all of that stuff. So taller than 2 feet is definitely not necessary. As far as loading the bottom with drainage, cardboard, et cetera, great question. When we're doing our raised bed gardens, we typically put them on top of rock, and that will be in the next slide. And that helps with protecting the product, the wood. And then the drainage itself, the organic soils, that piece we actually didn't spend a ton of time on this slide with. So thank you for reminding me. The organic soils, using the compost, using the correct soil mix, those are going to help with drainage. You're not going to have this compacted clay-like substance. So thank you so much for reminding me to point out those pieces.
Miles also kind of leading into that. What about metal feed tubes, galvanized?
I would like clarity on the question. Are you asking, oh, tubs, metal feed tubs. Gotcha. Yeah,
the troughs, basically.
The troughs, totally. Yeah. Troughs, metal troughs are actually a fantastic way to do it. The galvanized ones, you know, that you see at like your local feed store even. The thing about those is that you do want to elevate them. We typically put them on casters on, you know, so that you can roll them around, but also that gives them some elevation, and you're going to want to put drainage holes through them. So we do some drainage holes in that metal feed tub, and then we will still line that with a landscape fabric so that soil is not just falling through those holes. And then having that elevation is going to help with that drainage as well. So they're not just sitting kind of on your patio or porch.
Awesome. One other question, this might be coming down the pipeline. Can you address protecting from deer and other animals a lot for those who live in the foothills and mountains?
Totally coming down the pipeline. Thank you so much, Becky. Yeah, we'll totally get to that. Thank you guys so much. Anything else for this piece?
That is it.
All right. Awesome. Well, we will go on forward. Number two is metal trellises. We talked about trellis support, and here's the thing. So these are some options that you have on my website, the Circle of Life Arch Trellis, the Garden of the Goddess Lattice Archway, some garden obelisks, and some panel trellising. So these are the things we recommend for you. And I'm going to mention metal because wood is not going to last as long. It will be okay for a few years. The other piece I want to mention for you is these archways. A lot of people envision things like peas or green beans that are vining to go up archways. I'm going to challenge you all to get rid of your tomato cages this year for your tomatoes. Use them for something else, fine. But don't use tomato cages for tomatoes. You're going to want to use them, you know, for a smaller plant. So these garden obelisk trellises are going to be great for those. Or if you're connecting two or more beds, these archways are going to be really beautiful for you to connect those two beds. It's going to feel like a space, and then you can actually grow the tomato vines up that, because a lot of our tomatoes are going to keep vining if we let them. And so metal trellises are going to be really important for you, and panel trellises for some of the designs as well. So these particular pieces you can get on gratefulgardenllc.com. The reason I am talking about that is because, sure, there are tons of options for archways, but a lot of them aren't going to be made in a way that's going to be able to support the weight of what you're putting on them, like some, you know, cheap big box retailer version, or also the wind, right? If you're in Colorado, you know that the wind can rip through here, and it's pretty crazy, and it's going to bend some lesser sturdy builds. So save yourself some headache and have that there. So here's the reason why, not these. So before, my before picture, this is a beautiful arch trellis that I made out of my old plum tree cuttings and that I had, you know, tied together. And this archway lasted about 2 years. So, you know, if it is a short-term thing, it's fine. But then you can see this is the most recent snow just from a week ago. And it just completely finally broke. And that's going to happen when you're using wooden or found or made. And then the before also for the tomato cages. If this is your first year, you're going to see this tiny, cute little plant and you're going to think, oh my gosh, there's no way that's going to get big enough. But that second picture That's supposed to say after, but that second picture, you can see that that tomato cage stops right there and the fruit is still another foot or two above it. So, those are some really very personal reasons of why these other items don't work. So next we're going to go to the borders. Borders are really nice because they protect the bed. So we use either stone or steel edging. In this picture, it's our very first raised garden bed from 12 years ago where we used a plastic edging. And while that worked okay for maybe a few years, it just couldn't withstand the mower and the weed whacker and got all wiggly wobbly and wasn't a great fit. So we definitely recommend either steel or stone or something that's more durable like that. And what's great about this, this is the thing that borders are really important to me about, is pets and children, but pets. Most of us have, let's call them a lovable dog that has a lot of energy, right? And they know that this food tastes good. They're going to love the carrots. They're going to eat the strawberries. They're going to want to eat this food. And just like how in my open floor plan at my house, it's all one room, but my kitchen has tile and my living room has carpet. And when I ask the dog to get out of the kitchen, they know there's this border. They know where they're allowed to be. I've trained her to be like, dog's out, and she goes back over to the carpet. And so borders are really that first step to getting your dogs to not step into your space. And you can be like, nope, get out. And they're not getting to yours. The next piece is for children, right? It helps them realize this is a special space. This is a place that has our garden in it. And for us as well, it creates that special space. And so borders are really that kind of first thing to make it feel beautiful, make it great for your pets and your people, and let them know about that. And so before I move on to the next piece, I just wanted to make sure that I didn't lose anyone along the way. Are we good to go?
Thumbs up. No questions in the chat. Awesome. The tomato cages is fascinating to me. I thought that was interesting. Sage a message and said, I heard steel edging cuts dogs' paws.
You know, I have had a landscaper talk to me about that. And the thing is that there are ones that are kind of like curved at the top, and I've had a lot of experience with other gardeners and people doing the same thing and using these things where they haven't had an issue or a problem. And it does kind of help with that, like, you don't go over there. So if that is still a big concern for you, go ahead and use brick or, you know, a different kind of stone edging. If it's installed properly though, it's not supposed to be super high either. It's supposed to be dug down and it's supposed to, you know, have some things on it. And you're going to also have rock that's going up to it. So if your dog is naughty and getting into your garden anyway, you know, they would be stepping into the rock, you know, as well. So, it is something I've also heard, but I haven't actually met anyone yet that had that experience personally. So definitely take that with, you know, a grain of salt from me as well. And, you know, if that is your concern, go ahead and choose the brick. Awesome. Well, yeah. And then the next piece would be the pathways, right? So guys, this is the place where I'm going to give you the what I consider to be best advice of the entire presentation. Make your pathways not too wide or too small. The best piece of advice here is the 3-foot rule. In between your two beds, you're gonna want 3 feet between them. What you see here is 2.5 feet from my personal garden. And while the picture on the right shows it looks fine and big enough, once that those plants get grown in and it gets to be more lush, 2.5 feet is not big enough. It's also not big enough for you and a wheelbarrow, which is going to be important as throughout the season, you're going to be adding compost or, in, you know, the next year, you're going to be adding more soil and those kinds of things. The other part about this is, especially in Colorado, you know, wood mulch doesn't do great. This is wood mulch over top of landscape fabric. It's going to all get replaced with rock here in the next bit, because what ends up happening is it does degrade, it turns into dirt. And then, you know, you can see that there are going to be weeds inside of your pathway anyway. So we highly recommend making your pathway a weed-free zone. You're going to put down your landscape fabric. You're going to put down your rock and then your stepping stones if you choose to have those, and then having those pathways be at least 3 feet. And then the 1 to 2 feet on the sides, that's just on the borders, right? If you are, you know, up front and having that border, you know, at least 1 foot away from the front of it, that's more to protect it from your mower and weed whacker and things like that. And then the sides about that 1 to 2 feet. Okay. But as long as you can get between the beds, 3 feet is going to be your absolute key factor there. And the bonus. So I said there were 4 things, but of course there's always something extra at the end that you're like, oh my gosh, protection, right? Protection. So many deer. And it's kind of one of those things where I aspire to live somewhere that's not suburbia, that's not all fence, that will be able to have deer coming through. And so deer, rabbits, you know, any other things like that. So the other protection that we need is from frost or from hail. So it can be something as simple as metal hoops and some mesh cloth. Like you see here, these are PVC actually, you know, hoops that you can cover with mesh cloth, frost cloth, or shade cloth, or cold frames. And this protection is really great. We can actually start planting in Denver, Colorado right now at the end of March, outdoors, some of your cold vegetables. And these are gonna be peas and lettuces and greens. And those things can be planted outside right now. And if you had some extra protection, especially if you know a hail or a really strong frost is coming, you know, you just cover them up, or some of them just leave them be actually. And then the next piece is a garden house. So this is what I consider a frame that you just put on top of your garden beds. And so this would be something that you could either open up the doors of that's just exactly on your garden beds, or you could just pick up and take off, you know, when you're harvesting or, you know, maintaining your stuff. And that's going to be for things like, you know, your rabbits and stuff. And then the last one would be fencing. So simply making this a beautiful space around your garden, building that fence all the way around it, having the space where deer absolutely cannot get to it. And some people do end up putting like a lid on top of that and making that kind of a bigger version of a garden house, you know, where they're making this a completely encapsulated space. I don't know what to tell you about those squirrels, but for those deer, some people even, depending on your acreage, plant a deer garden. They plant a border garden on the outskirts of their property that they are literally giving to the deer. And they're not going to come into your personal garden if you are feeding them outside of your garden. So there's other ways to think about protection too, that some people may be like, oh my gosh, like I never even thought to have that. Now, yes, there are plants, you know, companion planting and smelly plants and things like that, that you can plant, and it can maybe deter some people. But if you're hungry enough, you're going to just kind of hold your nose and go to the thing over there anyway, right? So there are some products and plants and other ways that you can mitigate some of that. But when we're also talking about things like moths or things like, you know, cabbage worms or things like that, the best way is just going to have something covering it from the beginning, that mesh cloth or frost cloth or something like that. And that will just protect them from, you know, day one. You also can have things called trap crops, which is, you know, like, you know, a smelly thing where all the aphids are going to go to that thing and they're going to live there. and they're going to you're just going to give up that plant for them because then they're not on your other plants. So there are a lot of other kind of pieces about protection that we can go over in your coaching, in your one-on-ones, and kind of talk about that with you. So, but these are your overall ones. Yes, Molly. Oh my goodness. The question is, will all types of cloth mentioned work to protect against hail, or at least to some extent? The answer is yes, if you have the hoops that are going to be able to hold that hail off of your plant. So as you see in the picture, those hoops are going to be, this one has actually a crossbar this way as well. I don't know if you can see my pointer, but there's one that has a crossbar as well. And that's going to help keep that cloth up above. So if things are hitting it, it's not going to decimate your plants. So that's a really great question. Some people also use things like their milk jugs and cloches and things to protect individual plants against hail, if that's happening. But if you are, you know, growing a pretty extensive garden, you're not going to want to one by one protect each plant, you know, in the next month or so. So those cloths are a really great way to do that. Thank you for such a great question. The last thing I want to talk about making your garden successful. First off, it's most likely not your fault that your plants die. I just want to leave you with that piece. If you've brought a plant home and you planted it and it died, it's most likely not your fault. You're going to want to start with a strong foundation by buying plants from your local nursery instead of big box retailers. Because the thing is that local nurseries are meant for your climate. They're going to be more knowledgeable. They are gardeners. And with that, they're also going to be a little bit more in tune with your season as well. Whereas a big box retailer is going to, oh, Brie, I'm so jealous. big box retailers are going to sell the same thing across the country, regardless of where you're from. They are just buyers buying the same thing. And I'm going to tell you that my 12-year-old plum tree was from a big box retailer. And I was like, plums do great in Colorado. I'm making a good choice. This particular variety doesn't. And now I have this really beautiful plum tree that I have to baby to get plums off of. And I just can't even, tell you how much it hurts my heart because I don't want to cut it down. I don't want to start again. So really make sure you're sourcing stuff locally. And so, Nick's Garden Center, City Floral, those are just two of the, you know, ones here in Colorado. There are so many more that you guys can do, you know, and have there. And so, before we go, you know, any further, I just want to kind of open the room, see if there's any other questions. Don't mind the fact that I have some random words in my slides that don't make sense. I'll take those out later. What do you think, Becky?
I feel like we all have random words in our life these days that don't make sense.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's open up to questions. Anything, you know, particular, are you willing to open it up to anything outside of this presentation?
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, if for people who are getting ready to plant their gardens, questions, what questions do you have? Oh, we have Katrina. We have our experts. Miles, you should be able to unmute yourself.
Yeah, thanks. You know, one other question that I have is this, there's so many different types of soil, so many different types of compost and different characteristics for all of them now when you go to a store to buy them. What would you suggest is kind of not the bare minimum, but what's appropriate, I guess, just to help navigate everything that's out there?
Yeah, that is a fantastic question. Are you local here in Colorado, Miles?
Yeah, I'm in Superior.
Okay, fantastic. That makes answering your particular question easier because I can point you to a good supplier, right? But this is going to be another nursery thing, right? If you go to a local nursery that has a good garden mix, a garden soil, that would be where I would recommend you starting this. When you are starting your raised beds, especially for the very first time in miles, even actually anything over two raised beds, or even at two raised beds, depending on the size, you're going to need a truckload. You're not going to be buying this in bags. So you're going to want to find a place that is going to deliver to you in truckloads that has a garden mix. And this mix is going to need to be a healthy mix between a topsoil, a compost with a fertilizer, and, you know, really do your research there. NYX has a fantastic garden soil mix that I usually just point, you know, DIYers to, because they do deliver by the truckload, I think, as well, if you needed that, because they have a soil yard. So those of you that are not in Denver, Colorado, and don't have access to that, you know, I just really recommend doing just a little bit extra research, not necessarily going to your landscaping place, but maybe finding what your local nursery uses, you know, and doing your work backwards that way. But you want to look for words like outdoor garden soil, outdoor raised bed soil, you know, words like organic, of course, are going to be fantastic as well for that. So you're also going to want to feed your soil, because the soil feeds the plants. So when you're feeding your soil, you're going to top dress it with about, you know, 1 to 2 inches of compost throughout the season. So, you know, usually we just do that 3 times a year here at the beginning, middle, and, you know, near that end push, here in Colorado. If you, are warmer longer, you don't have all four seasons, you know, go ahead and do it for all four seasons. But, you know, we really only need to worry about spring, summer, and fall here for that top dressing for that. I'm so excited about your project, awesome. Miles, and I want to see it.
I'll take some pictures when we get it set up.
There will be pictures involved.
Good.
I love it. We do have some questions in the chat, but I think, Lori, were you raising your hand? Did you have a question?
I put it in the chat, but I'll say it. For strawberries, raspberries, and blackberries, would you put them in the raised beds, containers, or in the ground?
Yes. So all those three things that you mentioned are going to be perfectly fine either way. But my strawberry patch is in ground. And if you, again, are sourcing something from not a big box, you know, retailer, and locally, they're going to have better success. Same with blackberries and raspberries. I typically had those in about like a little 6-inch, you know, border separated space, and still was backfilling in with some healthy soil and nutrients for that, because the clay, if you're in Colorado, is just crazy. And they are going to need a little bit extra love, those blackberries and raspberries, to get them established. But once they do, they're going to be fine in that. And, you know, you might not really need to feed them as much. So I call those the perennial gardens. And the perennial gardens, you can absolutely have those in ground in certain spaces. Strawberries will be okay in containers, but they do want to keep, you know, spreading out their babies and having more strawberries. And so, you know, you're going to have to be really diligent about that patch in a container. So I kind of let mine go wild in ground, and I have just a corner of my yard that's just a wild strawberry, horseradish, chive, sage space. So awesome. Great question. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can't hear you, Becky.
I'm on mute because I have to remember, mute, it's a thing. So a couple questions on seeds. Kelsey had asked, any advice for keeping your seed starters alive? She never has ton of luck growing from seeds. And there was kind of a question that fed off that of, should you start from seeds or buy starter plants?
Yes, okay. I love this question. I actually just spent the last 2 months doing seed starting classes, and it just brings me so much joy, because when you start something from seed and it's yours and it's your baby, there's so much more magic to that. here's the thing. This is your hobby, right? So don't feel like you have to start everything from seed. Absolutely buy things that are already started, you know, from your local nurseries. That's going to be perfectly fine and acceptable, right? With any hobby, you're going to start where makes sense for you. And even I'm going to be purchasing some things that are already started that I just didn't have. So the best advice for keeping the seed starters alive, this is going to be available on my website as well. You know, you'll be able to see some past classes on this because this is a whole other class, right? But the first thing is when they're in the germination stage, they need to stay wet and covered. So wet and covered. Once they sprout, uncover them. And you're going to want them to be in a strong light. So while a window works great, if that hasn't worked for you in the past, a south or southwest facing window, and you're ready to invest, go ahead and get a grow light. And you're going to want that grow light to be just a couple inches above them at all times for them to not get super leggy and get to where they need to be. So the other part about keeping them alive is saying hello to them every morning and every night and saying kind words to them and touching them while you're saying hello. Some people just use a fan, but fans often dry out the soil and might be too constant of movement. But if you're just touching your plants and helping them get strong, people and plants need adversity to grow. We need to have movement. We need to have that air around us. We need to have that pushback to get strong and to grow. And so that's another reason why. And I'll just say, there's a ton of other advice I can give you, but the last part, the reason a lot of seed starts die, and I see this a lot in schools where teachers have their kids, you know, do this, is that they're not hardening them off before planting them. And what that means is you need to get your seed start, if it grew fine inside, but it dies when it gets outside, you need to have it in a safe space outside and shade, away from wind for a couple of days, and bringing it in if the night temperatures get too cold, and then bringing it back out and getting it used to it. And then finally, putting your seed starts in the space your garden's going to be, but still don't take them out of their containers and destroy their roots. Just get them really used to that environment, because otherwise they are going to die. They're going to be like, ah, this is too hot, too windy, too, you know, temperature drastic. And so that's probably one of the biggest pieces of advice. And I think on my website right now, on the banner on the top, I totally have a whole PDF on seed starting, you know, advice and help there. So that will also help you through any of the things I missed in this quick rundown.
I will also suggest the seed planting workshop classes are insanely fun. You get to play in dirt and have fun and hang out. So recommend checking those out. We're going to switch to water real fast. A couple of questions came in about water. Bree mentions that she loves the morning ritual of watering her garden, but she feels like a drip line is more efficient. Is there any happy medium? And kind of tying into that, Kat had brought up, you know, that we do have drought in Colorado. And so how can we provide enough water to our plants, but be able to mitigate water use, especially as we start to have water restrictions?
Oh my God, I love this. First off, get rid of your lawns, stop watering them. No. and just use your water allotment for your garden, right? Because lawns aren't helping us. But that very veiled joke that is a truth aside, the reason raised beds work so well with the correct soil in it is because you're not losing the water to the clay. It's not getting sucked right back up into the earth. It's staying within your system. And so mitigating the drought impact and increasing, you know, your ability to water your plants, the biggest important thing is watering deeper and longer instead of watering more frequently. So for our raised beds, we're going to water in the morning before it gets hot for a deeper and longer time versus throughout the day, like, oh, now it's the middle of the day and they look dry and thirsty, I'm going to go water them again. And then as your production gets to be more and more water needy, because a lot of our food is water, right? You can then add maybe a nighttime watering to that as well, in the height of your, you know, production. And that deeper, longer watering is going to just help saturate all of that soil and get it to where it wants to be. And so that would be, you know, more of a 15 minute long water with a drip line versus 5 minutes, three times a day, that kind of thing. And so a lot depends on, you know, your size of beds and where you're at and your location. But I do recommend that drip line is going to actually be the most efficient, because oftentimes when we're watering from a hose or from by hand, we're still not getting right on top of the soil. We're still maybe wetting the leaves or wetting, you know, the plants, and that's not going to help them either. You know, we really want to get that soil saturation, not the plants. So hopefully that helps.
Thank you. I'm going to come back up here for a second. Kelsey had asked about filling and layering, and I'm losing my headphones. One moment, please. As we're filling and layering our beds, is there any difference between layers for plants?
Oh, great. So you're asking about the actual planting plans, or are you asking about filling and layering the beds with the soils?
Yeah, I was more asking like filling and layering the beds with the soils. Like if I'm going to have a planter that's dedicated to tomatoes, does that need like more sticks or more compost or something that's just like more herb-based? I know that there's like 3 to 5 layers or something like that that you're supposed to do in your bed. And so I was just curious if that there were any specifications on plants or if it was kind of the same throughout.
Kelsey brings up a really fantastic conversation. There are hundreds of ways to grow a garden. The way that you are talking about it is more of a layering in a bunch of organic materials that aren't soil to then create this healthy soil. And while that is a perfectly fine and fantastic way to go, the issue is that you're introducing also a lot of other things into your soil that you just may not want to manage and maintain, like weeds and you know, certain things that you don't want in there. So when we're filling up our beds, we are using a mix that is already, you know, mixed into a soil and has been fed with the compost and with the manures and things like that. We're not doing like sticks and stones and, you know, certain other foods. When we are making compost, our own composts in our yards, we're still putting that finished compost that has already cooled down and is ready to feed your foods as well into those beds. And so the way Grateful Garden does it is with those finished soils, finished composts, and we're not trying to create soil from scratch, which is ultimately kind of what you're talking about by layering and filling those beds, is you're creating soil from scratch. And we are just sourcing soil that's already gone through that process.
Thank you. Building off that, partner plants. What are your thoughts on partner plants such as tomato and basil?
Partner plants are my favorite. I love friends. The way that we do our planting plans is very kind of intensive. It's not going to be your row gardens. And I probably should have mentioned that up front, is that a kitchen garden is not your agriculture row garden where everything's in a row and it's all the same plant. Because if everything is in a row and all the same plant, that pest or bug is going to just decimate your entire row. But if you have a tomato plant, then surrounded by basil plants, and then surrounded by marigolds, and then having, you know, a pepper plant and carrots, and then you do that again, and then have all of those again over here, if something does get overtaken by a pest, that pest is most likely going to stay there in that one space versus hopping over to the next thing and then eating all the other thing. So especially when you're talking about brassicas, like, you know, your broccolis and cabbages and things like that, you know, if they're all going to be together, it's going to be easier for that pest to take them. So we absolutely love intensive planting, companion planting, trying to fill up that soil with plants too. That was actually another piece of the water mitigation, is if you can't see your soil, the sun can't dry it out. So if you are layering in things underneath of your tomato plants, like lettuces, things that need cool weather, need shade, aren't going to do great in the summer, they actually might do okay under those bigger plants, and they'll kind of be your ground cover too. So layering your plants, companion planting is a huge win in my book. I absolutely love it. And I think that we could all learn from, you know, being friends with people who are different from us too. It's just, there's so much to learn from the garden and, you know, with people and plants. So thank you so much for bringing that up.
I love that. I think there's just so much to learn from nature as humans, right? Real fast, Kat had one more question about, could you recommend, which I think is xeriscape plants, food plants? Do you have any recommendations on that?
Yeah, so that is a whole nother topic, because you're escaping and what you mean by that and food plants. And it sounds to me like you're asking about things that need less water or, you know, less maintenance. To me, that would be more of a perennial garden that's going to just work well in your space. And so while I can't recommend specific things for you in this episode, that is definitely a conversation that I'd love to continue further on. But I would recommend just looking for things that are drought tolerant, you know, when you're doing your research, looking for things that you'll be able to have, you know, in your space as a perennial over and over again, things that, you know, you're not going to have to use as an annual and pull out and reseed. So that is a whole nother topic. And I would love to get into that someday with this community.
I love that. Thank you, Katrina. Well, you have Absolutely. Been a wealth of information, and you're going to put up your information here about how to work with you. We will also send out a follow-up that will include slides that will have Katrina's information. We highly recommend get in touch with her, follow her on Instagram and Facebook. It is a wealth of information that I think I get to learn every single day from you. And I'm just so honored that we get to have you as a part of Women in Sustainability so that you can share your time, your experience, your expertise. As we know, we love trees, so we will be planting 2 trees in your honor as a thank you for today. We do have our community series coming up. It is the 4th Wednesday of every month. Right now we are booked through August. We have several of our speakers here. Bree is actually going to be our April speaker. She is speaking on sustainable operations. Kat is going to be our August speaker. She is going to talk about footprints. And so highly recommend checking out our community series. This is members of Women in Sustainability who are having opportunity to share their expertise with us as a whole community. We do have a lot of other events coming up. Always go to womeninsustainability.org, check out of our events, get involved. And we are so excited to see all of you either virtual or in person soon. And thank you for attending today. Thank you. A huge thank you to Katrina for sharing this information. I feel, yes, that I've learned so much from you today.
You guys are awesome. Thank you so much. I'd love to hear from you and see your gardens. If you're on Instagram, go ahead and give me a follow, Grateful Garden, because especially for those of you who are building your gardens this year, it gives me so much joy to see that there's more food and gardens in this world. So thank you so, so much. And if you do want to hop on for a free 20-minute discovery call, that's where I recommend everyone to start with us. And I feel silly for not having the slide up that whole time. That's what I'd meant to do. So here we go. So thank you guys so much. I look forward to meeting and seeing all of you in person. And yeah, happy growing.
Happy growing, everybody. Spring is here. Happy spring. I love it. Have a great day. Enjoy it. Great to see everybody.
Thanks, guys.